Chant and dance as much as possible in this human form of life.
Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjanashalakhaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadham Hiyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Pada Kamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swamin Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadhi Paschatya Deshatarine Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Gurave Gaura Chandraya Radhikaya Tadalaye Krishnaya Krishna Bhaktaya Tad Bhaktaya Namo Namaha Ananda Leelamaya Vigrahaya Hemavadivya Chavisundaraya Tasmai Maha Prema Rasapradaya Chaitanya Chandraya Namo Namaste Chaitanya Chandraya Namo Namaste Chaitanya Chandraya Namo Namaste Hare Krishna. Before I begin, I would want to express my heartfelt gratitude at the lotus feet of Abhay Charanaravinda, Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada, and all the predecessor acharyas and all the disciples of Srila Prabhupada, who have very mercifully given us this most ripened fruit, most juicy fruit, the mango on the tree of Vedic wisdom, that is Srimad Bhagavatam. Secondly, I want to express my gratitude to Narayan Keshav Prabhu, to Audarya Gaurachandra Prabhu for very kindly having me back in your Sangha at the service of all the assembled devotees. And finally, I seek the blessings of all the assembled devotees here. I pray for your best wishes and blessings so that I can speak some favorable words in the glorification of today's topic. Vancha kalpatarobhyascha kripa sindhubhya evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha. We generally find that whenever the speaker is very exalted and the audience are equally very exalted, the result is a miracle. The speaker is Krishna and the listener is Arjuna and the result is Bhagavad Gita. The speaker is Shukadev Goswami. The listener is Parikshit Maharaj and the result is Srimad Bhagavatam. So whenever the speaker is very glorious and the audience are equally very glorious, the result is completely extraordinary. But unfortunately today, the speaker is not very exalted, but the audience are very exalted. So that's the reason I want to really express my gratitude and really pray for all the blessings so that I may speak something very favorable in the glorification of Vritrasura, who is the celebrated godly demon in the sixth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. We find Srimad Bhagavatam is so glorious that it is compared to Ganga Devi. Vaktaram prachakam kshotram yatpadam salilam yatha. The Srimad Bhagavatam describes that just like Ganga, the place where Gangaji originates, that is Gangotri, that place is pure. Wherever it flows through, it makes that place also pure. And finally, wherever Gangaji reaches, the final destination, it makes that place also pure. Similarly, Shukadev Goswami says, this Srimad Bhagavatam is like that all pure Ganga. Vaktaram, the person who speaks, becomes pure. Vaktaram prachakam kshotram, the person who hears also becomes pure. And prachakam, the person who asks questions, they also become completely pure. So no worries, even if there are no questions, if we are attentively hearing, we will still get purified. But the point that is made here is Bhagavatam is so glorious that the speaker, the listener, and those who ask questions, or those who are just attentive, because we find in Kali Yuga, just to be attentive is a very humongous task, especially for me today, because I am right now in Seattle, Washington, and the time here is morning 3 a.m. So more than all the audience here, it is a big challenge for the speaker to be awake today. So Bhagavatam is like that, all pure like Gangaji. Shukadev Goswami describes that atra sarga visargascha sthanam poshanam utaya manmantara ishanukata nirodham muktim ashraya. These are the 10 subject matters, the 10 topics of Srimad Bhagavatam, which starts from Canto 3 all the way up to Canto 12. So the first two cantos form a prelude, and the Canto 3 to Canto 12 discusses 10 topics. What are these 10 topics? Atra sarga. Sarga means primary creation. Visarga, which means secondary creation. Atra sarga visargascha sthanam. Sthanam means cosmic manifestation. We find in the fifth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, Shukadev Goswami beautifully describes the complete cosmic manifestation. He describes the 28 types of hell as to what are the activities when done will naturally attract our way to any of those 28 types of hell. So those are the different cosmic manifestation. And then comes poshanam. Poshanam means protection. And this poshanam, dear devotees, forms the theme of the sixth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. The topic that we are trying to discuss comes from the sixth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So before we dive into that topic, I thought of setting the stage as to what this canto basically deals with. So this canto forms the theme called as poshanam, which means protection by the Supreme Lord. Protection not only of the physical body, but also protection of the faith of the devotees. The Supreme Lord here protects the faith, nourishes the faith, and maintains his devotees. And also, in the due course, provides physical protection. And if in one line we have to sum up the recurring theme of this whole canto has one recurring theme. And that recurring theme, dear devotees, is errors, mistakes, rectification. Errors, mistakes, rectification. Time and again, every chapter we'll find there are errors, there are mistakes, and then there is rectification. Then there is prayaschitta. And again, back to square one. Punar mushiko bhava. Again making mistakes, again rectification, again making mistakes, and again rectification. So this is the theme of the whole sixth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And dear devotees, there is one personality who literally signifies this, who is like the acharya of committing mistakes. Throughout the Srimad Bhagavatam, we'll find he literally makes it clear that how a person should not behave. No guesses, this person is Indra, who is the celebrated anti-hero of the Govardhan Leela. And it is not just the Govardhan Leela, dear devotees. From the first canto till the 12th canto, Indra shows by example how not to be. There are devotees by whom we can take inspiration to learn how we have to be on this path. And then there are devotees like Indra who teaches how not to be on this path. And Indra is literally the acharya of committing mistakes and then rectifying them. So Indra was once in his Swargaloka. He was sitting with his wife, Sachi Devi. She's, of course, a less known Sachi Devi. The more popular Sachi Devi is the mother of Sri Gauranga Mahaprabhu. But the wife of Indra, she's also called as Sachi Devi. So Indra was sitting with Sachi Devi, and the Kim Purushas and the Siddhas and the Kinharas and the Apsaras and the Urvashi and Menaka, they were all dancing and chanting and were glorifying Indra. And naturally, we find when there is too much glorification, when we are in a place where there is too much glorification, naturally the head spins. We take it for granted that, oh, I am someone very great. I am someone very exalted. And Indra is no exception. He knows all the philosophy. Perhaps he knows the philosophy better than all of us. But in these situations, Indra somehow gets caught. He gets caught in the trap. So all the Kim Purushas and the Siddhas and the Kinnaras, they were all singing and chanting. And at this point, Indra starts to feel that he is the doer. He starts to feel, well, I am someone very great. All this is actually for me. I am the doer. We find Krishna makes this point in the Bhagavad Gita. Prakrite kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvashaha ahankara vimudatma kartam iti manyate. Chapter 3, text 27, the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, Prakrite kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvashaha ahankara vimudatma. The person who thinks that he is the doer, he is vimuda. So Krishna could have just used the word muda. Muda means someone who's foolish. But Krishna uses vimuda, which means vishesha rupena muda. That person is not just a fool, he's a special fool. Anyone who thinks that he is the doer, he's a special fool. So Indra at this point starts to think that, oh, he's someone very great. And whenever we think that we are very great, we are the doer, naturally it opens the gates for Vaishnava Parada. Because when we think we are great, there is lack of humility. When there is lack of humility, there is going to be Vaishnava Parada. So at this point, Brihaspati enters the assembly. Who's Brihaspati? Well, Brihaspati is the guru of all the demigods. People, especially from the south part of India, will be very much familiar with Brihaspati. Especially those from Kerala will be very familiar with Brihaspati. The reason being, when Krishna was departing after his pastimes, earthly pastimes in Dwapar Yuga, when Krishna was again departing to go back to Golok Vrindavan, at that time Krishna gave a deity of his own to Brihaspati. And Krishna said, you install this deity in the most holiest, in the most purest place in this world. So Brihaspati took on this instruction of Krishna to establish the small deity of Krishna, the baby form of Krishna, in the most holiest place. But now it was a difficult task for Brihaspati to go from place to place to find out as to which place is the most holiest. So he called upon Vayu. He called upon Vayudev and he said, look, I have the deity of Krishna and you are Vayu. So you can travel to all the places in split second, which I cannot. So let us do one thing. I will sit on your back and you take me to different places. And the place which we feel is the most holiest, we will install this deity. And dear devotees, the place where Brihaspati installed this deity of Krishna is nothing but the place called as Guruvayur. Because this place is called as Guruvayur because the deity of Krishna was installed by Guru, that is Brihaspati and Vayudev. So Vayu and Brihaspati, that is Guru, both came together to install this deity. And that is where this place till date is called as Guruvayur. So that Guru, Brihaspati, he enters the scene when Indra is completely intoxicated in pride. And when Brihaspati enters, everyone get up. Everyone offer their respects. Everyone offer their dandavat pranams to Brihaspati. But the only person who doesn't get up and by who teaches by example how not to be is Indra. Indra starts thinking to himself, well, they are all getting up, but I don't have to. I am Devaraj. and the king of the Swargaloka. I don't have to get up, even if it's my own spiritual master walking. So Brihaspati comes and Indra doesn't get up. And naturally, Brihaspati gets offended. So Brihaspati storms out of this assembly. And we find wherever there is Vaishnava Aparad, Krishna will make sure that the person is doomed. I'll put it that way. Krishna will make sure that that person is completely doomed. Because we find Krishna in the Bhagavatam, he says, Aham Bhakta Paradhino, Yas Svatantra Ivadvija Sadhubir Grasta Hridayam Bhakter Bhakta Janapriya. For Krishna, his devotees are everything. And for the devotees of the Lord, Krishna is everything. The devotees cannot live without Krishna, and Krishna can never ever live without his devotees. We find in the 9th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the pastime of Ambarish Maharaj, the Sudarshan Chakra was chasing Durvasa Muni. Durvasa Muni, who was so powerful, who gets angry in split second, he couldn't do anything when the Sudarshan Chakra was chasing. Why? Because there was Vaishnava Aparad. Where there is Vaishnava Aparad, even the Lord does not protect. He can protect, but he will make sure he doesn't protect. So this is a very important point, dear devotee. Srila Radhanath Maharaj, in one class, he was making this point that the tongue is meant for the glorification of the Lord. Vani gunanu kathane shravanau katayam hastau cha karmasu manas tavapada yorna. The 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam describes Vani, our tongue is meant for glorification of the Supreme Lord. But when that tongue is not used for the glorification of Krishna and used to criticize devotees left, right, and center, Srila Radhanath Swami Maharaj was saying that is the point we should cut our tongue off, because that is not the purpose why Krishna has given this tongue. So very important and a very subtle point that we find throughout all our scriptures, not just the Srimad Bhagavatam, to be very wary of not committing Vaishnava Aparad. So Indra commits this Vaishnava Aparad unto Brihaspati. And Brihaspati leaves this assembly. And the moment Brihaspati leaves this assembly, Indra, he goes low on self-confidence. There is a guilt in his heart. He starts feeling to himself, I should have not done it. There is something wrong that I did. So you find Indra is like a pendulum. He keeps swinging from a gentleman to a mentalman, to a gentleman, to a mentalman. Like a pendulum, Indra will keep swinging. At one point, he will speak top-notch philosophy. And the next point, he will criticize a Vaishnava. The next point, he will even kill a Vaishnava. And then he will repent. And then again, back to square one. He will again speak philosophy. So like a pendulum, he just keeps swinging in every canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So here he commits a mistake towards his spiritual master, Brihaspati. Now there is a guilt. He starts feeling, why did I do that? I should have not done it. And we find many times when we do something, there is a guilt in our heart also. What is that guilt? Who is providing that guilt? It is Krishna in the form of Paramatma who gives us that guilt. Because Krishna says, Aham Sarvasva Prabhava. Everything is emanating from him. So even the guilt that we find comes from the Supreme Lord. So naturally, Indra got this guilt and he thought to himself, there is something wrong that I have done. And now when he went low on self-confidence because of that guilt, at this time, the demons, the daityas led by Shukracharya, they thought to themselves, this is the right time to attack. Because diplomacy, when the enemies are going low on self-confidence, that's the time you go and attack them so that you can claim their kingdom. So Shukracharya is the guru for all the demons. So Shukracharya thought to himself, the king of the demigods, Indra, is now low on self-confidence. This is the time we should go and attack the Swargaloka and take the whole Swargaloka. So when Indra got low on confidence, the demons with full weapons led by Shukracharya, they attacked. And naturally when they attacked, Indra had no answer. He was running here and there. Rakshasvamam, protect me. So we find this started because of Vaishnava Aparad. So he starts running here and there. And he goes to Brahmaji. He says, Brahma, please protect me. Brahma says, what is this? Have some shame. Every alternate day you're coming, you're saying you committed a mistake, you want some rectification. Have some shame, Baba. You are the king of Swargaloka. You cannot behave this way. Indra says, I am sorry. I will make sure this is the last time. I will not commit any other mistakes. But this is only for saying. We find again in the 10th canto, he is going to commit the Govardhan Leela. So time and again, Indra speaks, but he never practices. So the lesson that we learn here, dear devotees, is knowing the philosophy doesn't make us a devotee. Application of that philosophy is very important. We may know all the philosophy. Hiranyakashipu knew all the philosophy. Ravana knew all the philosophy. But when it came to application, their application was completely zero. So the application part is very important. That is what decides whether one is a devotee or not. And it's not the verses and the purports. That is to help us remember Krishna at the time of death. That those purports and those verses are so that we can apply in the time of crisis, in the time of calamity. But Indra somehow, he makes sure that he doesn't apply it in his life. So he goes to Brahma. And when Brahmaji gets to know that the demons have attacked the Swargaloka, Brahma says, well, the only solution I find here is you go down and take shelter of the son of Tvashta called as Vishwarup. Brahma says, go and take shelter of the son of Tvashta who is called as Vishwarup. So we find this name Vishwarup is also very prominent in the pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Mahaprabhu is called as Vishwambar, but Mahaprabhu's older brother is called as Vishwarup. So we are doing Srimad Bhagavatam. At the same time, we are also doing Chaitanya Bhagavatam. We are doing both side by side. So Indra is asked to take shelter of Vishwarup. Brahma sends him down. So Indra comes down and he meets Vishwarup. And he tells Vishwarup, oh Vishwarup, I need your help. I need your protection. And Vishwarup says, what is it? Indra says, I want to make you my guru. I want to take instructions from you. There is a calamity in my life and I need instructions from you. So when Vishwarup hears this, Vishwarup says, wait a minute. You are Devaraj and you are the king of Swargaloka. And Vishwarup, Bhagavatam describes, was a very young child. He was very young in age. So he tells Indra that, how can I become your guru? I'm so young in age. The interesting point, dear devotees, here is we find in Chaitanya Charitamrita, this point is made that what is the qualification for becoming a guru? Can an American bodied person become a guru? Can an Indian bodied person become a guru? Does guru have something to do with age? Does guru have something to do with countries? Does guru have something to do with race? Do these material qualifications have anything to do with the qualification of becoming a guru? The Chaitanya Charitamrita, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, very beautifully he describes as to what is the qualification for becoming a guru. Kiba vipra kiba nyasi shudra kene nai jai krishna tatva veti sei guru hai. Kaviraj Goswami describes kiba vipra. Someone can be a vipra. Vipra means a brahmana. Kibo nyasi, someone can be a sannyasi also. Shudra kene nai, someone can even be a shudra by birth. Jai Krishna tatva veti sei guru hai. Anyone who knows Krishna in truth from the bona fide source, he has the adhikar to become a guru. So he can be a sannyasi, he can be a brahmana, he can be a grahastha, he can also be born in a shudra family. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, these are all externals. If he knows Krishna Tattva in truth, he can become a guru. Like for example, if Prahlad Maharaj walks into our assembly, will we not accept Prahlad Maharaj as our guru? Of course we will accept. Likewise, if Dhruva Maharaj comes into the assembly, we will again accept Dhruva Maharaj as our guru. Because age has nothing to do with bhakti. Age has nothing to do with Guru Tattva. So Indra spoke this to Vishwarup. He told him that, look, the Shastras say that age has nothing to do. You may be young in age, but you are very powerful and you are very spiritually inclined. So I want to take your shelter. So Vishwaroop agreed. And then Vishwaroop said, what is the problem? How can I help you? How can I serve you? So Indra says, let me explain. I committed a mistake unto Brihaspati, because of which I went low on confidence. And because I went low on confidence, the Daityas led by Shukracharya, the demons led by Shukracharya, they attacked Swargaloka. And now I have lost my kingdom. I went to Brahmaji for advice and Brahmaji sent me here. So you please give me some advice. So when Vishwaroop hears this, Vishwaroop says, I will give you something by which you will again get back your Swargaloka. And that is the point where Vishwaroop, he tells Indra to nicely wash his hands, to nicely wash his face, to wash his feet, and to chant the mantra, Om Abhapavitra Pavitrava Sarvavasta Gatopiva Yasmaret Pundarikaksha Sabhayab Andara Shujihi. The Shastras describe Om Apavitra Pavitrava. Someone can be apavitra, someone can be impure, or someone can be pure. Sarvavasta Gatopiva, in all circumstances. Yasmaret Pundarikaksha. Anyone who remembers Pundarikaksha, that is Sri Krishna, Sabhayab Andara Sujihi. He becomes pure externally and he also becomes pure internally. So Vishwaroop said, you chant all these mantras. And when Indra chanted these mantras, that was the time Vishwaroop gave the invisible mantra kavach, invisible armor, invisible mantra shield in the form of Narayan Kavacha. Vishwaroop gives the famous Narayan Kavacha to Indra and says, you chant this Narayan Kavacha and you will be invincible. In fact, he says, you will become Ajita. You will be, no one can ever defeat you. You will always be victorious. That person who never loses in any battle, you will always become victorious. So he gives him the Narayan Kavacha and says, you chant this Narayan Kavacha. So it's very interesting that we can learn from this section that whenever there are calamities in our life, whenever there's obstacles, whenever there are impediments in our life, instead of taking help of others, instead of going around and taking sympathy from people around, we should actually take shelter of the prayers of Srimad Bhagavatam. We find these prayers in the form of Bhishma Stuti, Gajendra Stuti, Brahmar Geet, Gopi Geet, Kunti prayers, the prayers of Manigreva Nalakuvera, and likewise the Narayan Kavacha. These prayers are given so that at the time of obstacles, we take shelter of them and come out victorious. That is the success of studying Srimad Bhagavatam. At the time of crisis, we apply that in our real life. So whenever we have obstacles, in fact, even if we don't have obstacles, we can chant this Narayan Kavacha, which was given by Vishwaroop to Indra for protection. The Narayan Kavacha very beautifully describes Om Harer Vritya Mama Sarva Raksham Nyastyangri Padma Patagendra Prishti Darari Charma Sigadeshu Chapaha Pashanda Danoshta Gunoshta Bahu Jaleshu Mam Rakshatu Matsya Murtihi Yado Ganebhyo Varunasya Pashat. In this way, the Narayan Kavacha, it describes the Matsya avatar, it describes the Kurma avatar, it describes Varaha, it describes Narsinga, it describes Vamana, it describes Parushuram, it describes Ram, it describes Krishna, it describes Buddha, it describes Kalki, it describes Damodar, it describes Madhusudan, it describes Trivikram, it describes Keshava, it describes all the names of the Supreme Lord. So basically, Narayan Kavacha is nothing but different names of the Lord that are brought together for protection. And that is why our Shastras, time and again, they emphasize the chanting of the holy name. Because the name of the Supreme Lord is so powerful that even when Indra had obstacles in the form of losing his kingdom, the solution for that was the names of the Supreme Lord. So these names were given to Indra. And now Indra, with full confidence, he took the Narayan Kavacha and was now proceeding back to the Swargaloka in order to reclaim his lost kingdom. But here comes the twist. Here comes the climax. What happened was Vishwarup was doing something that Indra did not like. When Indra got to know that Vishwarup was doing this, Indra became furious. He was fuming with anger. What was Vishwarup doing? Vishwarup was connected to the demigods from his father's side. But Vishwarup was connected to the demon side through his mother's side. So he was connected to the demigods from his father's side, and Vishwarup was connected to the demons from his mother's side. So what Vishwarup was doing is, when he was doing yagya for the victory of Indra, he was doing the yagya for the demigods, and chukkese, without anyone knowing, he was also doing it for the demons. For the demigods, for the demons. For the demigods, for the demons. For the demigods, for the demons. So when Indra got to know, he became furious. And he was thinking to himself, wait a minute. I came here to seek protection so that I can get my kingdom back. And seems like Vishwarup is doing yagya not just for the demigods, but he's also doing it for the demons. How can he do it? Indra got very angry that Vishwarup was doing yagya for the demigods as well as for the demons. So in a fit of rage, Indra took his sword and he cut the three heads of Vishwarup. Vishwarup, Bhagavatam describes, had three heads. And a fit of rage, Indra takes his sword and just chops the three heads of Vishwarup. Now we see, he commits a mistake towards Brihaspati. To rectify that mistake, he goes to Brahma. Brahma sends him to Vishwarup, and now he has ended up even killing Vishwarup. So this is again Guru Aparad. And this is the worst form of Aparad, because he has killed Vishwarup. He has killed his spiritual master. The Hari Bhakti Vilas, where it beautifully describes that when we say Vaishnava Aparad is of six types. When we say, oh, I have done Vaishnava Aparad, this Vaishnava Aparad is classified into six types. What are the six types of Vaishnava Aparad? Shripad Sanatan Goswami describes, Hanti Nindanti Vaidveshti Vaishnava Nabhinandati Kridyate Yati No Harsha Darshane Patananishat. The Vaishnava Aparad is of six types. The first one is Hanti, which means to kill a Vaishnava. This is the most abominable, to kill a devotee of the Lord, to kill a Vaishnava. Second, Nindanti, to criticize the devotees. Third, Dveshti, to be envious of devotees. Fourth, Vaishnava Nabhinandati, to not offer dandavats on seeing a devotee. This is also Vaishnava Aparad. Many times we take it for granted that, oh, I know this devotee for many decades, I don't have to offer obeisances. But the Hari Bhakti Vilas describes, Vaishnava Nabhinandati, do not even offer obeisances on seeing a Vaishnava. This is a Vaishnava Aparad. Fifth, Kridyate, to be angry on a Vaishnava. And sixth, Yatino Harsha, to not be happy seeing a Vaishnava. When a Vaishnava is walking, to think that, oh, this Mataji speaks a lot. This Prabhuji keeps talking on continuously. To not be happy seeing a Vaishnava, this is also a Vaishnava Aparad, Hari Bhakti Vilas describes. Darshane Patanani Shat, these are the six types of Vaishnava Aparad. The first is Hanti, to kill a Vaishnava. Second, Nindanti, to criticize a Vaishnava. Third, Dveshti, to be envious of a Vaishnava. Fourth, to not offer obeisances on seeing a Vaishnava. Fifth, to be angry on a Vaishnava. And finally, the sixth one, to not be happy seeing a Vaishnava. So what was Indra doing here? He was doing the most highest form of Vaishnava Aparad, that is killing a devotee. He chopped off the three heads of Vishwarup, which was the most heinous crime possible. And now, naturally, the pendulum starts swinging. He killed Vishwarup, and now he starts thinking to himself, why did I do it? I should have not done it. I have done a great Vaishnava Aparad. So he will make a mistake and then he will repent. Then again, he will make a mistake, again, he will repent. So when Vishwarup was killed, Vishwarup's father, Tvashta, got to know that Vishwarup has been killed by Indra. So Tvashta became very angry and he thought to himself, I will do a yajna by which I will create a demon who will kill Indra. What does Indra think about himself? Indra is Devaraj. He is the king of the demigods, but that doesn't give him the adhikar. That doesn't give him the power to kill my son. My son was trying to help him and he has the audacity to come and kill my son. So Tvashta, the father, became very angry. Now, naturally, because Indra, he killed Vishwarup, he incurred sin. And he incurred a lot of sin. And for 1 year, the Shastras describe Indra suffered terribly. For 1 year, Indra suffered very badly. But after 1 year, the pendulum again starts swinging. He thinks to himself, wait a minute. I am Indra. Why should I suffer? I can give the suffering to others. I am Devaraj. I don't have to suffer. So we see there is no steadiness in Indra's life. He will make a mistake. He will repent. He will do prayaschitta. And again, he will make a mistake. So there is no improvement. Time and again, he will keep making his mistakes. And time and again, he will repent for those mistakes. So after 1 year of suffering for the crime that he did of killing Vishwarup, Indra thinks to himself that I will distribute my sins to 4 people. I will give my sins to 4 people. And in return, I will give them some benediction also so that they're happy and I am relieved of my sins. So thinking thus, Indra now goes to Mother Earth. He goes to Mother Earth and says, Mother Earth, O Bhumi Devi, will you take my sins? Will you partake? Will you take some of my sins? Bhumi Devi says, well, I will take your sins, but for that I need a benediction. Indra says, done, I will give you. Whatever benediction you want, I will give you. Just take my sins. So Bhumi Devi accepts, Mother Earth accepts it. And because Indra gave the sins to Mother Earth, deserts were formed in Earth where no spiritual activity can be performed. We see deserts are the place where no yajna, no spiritual activity can be performed. Why? Because it appeared because of the sinful reaction of Indra. And as benediction, Indra said that wherever there are ditches in Mother Earth, I will make sure that they are fulfilled. So that was the benediction that he gave Mother Earth. Second, he went to water and he said, will you partake in my sins? The water said, I will partake in your sins, but I need a benediction. Indra said, done. I will give you whatever benediction you want. Just take my sins away. So when water agreed, Indra gave a portion of his sins to water, because of which ripples were formed in water. We see ripples are never considered very good. It's not very auspicious as far as water is concerned. And that was formed because of the sins of Indra. And as benediction, what did Indra give? Indra blessed water that wherever you get added, you will be instrumental in increasing the quantity. Like we see, when there is milk, water is added, the quantity of milk increases. Wherever water is added, the quantity simply increases. So that was a benediction that Indra gave, that water will be instrumental in increasing the quantity. Third, Indra now goes to the trees and he says, will you take my sins? Will you take some of my sins? And the tree says, well, I will take your sins, but I also need some benediction. You give benediction to Mother Earth. You give benediction to water. I also need benediction. Indra says, done. Whatever you want, I will give you. Just take my sins. So Indra is keen on just giving his sins away so that he can again start committing sins. So he goes to the trees and he gives a portion of his sins to the trees, because of which sap was formed in the trees. And now we find sap is not something very useful for the trees. And as benediction, Indra blessed the trees that whenever you're cut, whenever your branches are cut, I bless you that it will again regrow. So till date, we find that's a blessing that the trees have. Whenever they're cut, they again grow. And finally, we know the Shastras describe that Indra went to women and said that, can you partake in my suffering? And as because of which we find women generally are monthly impure. And as benediction, what Indra gave is they can enjoy more physically. In this way, we find Indra, after killing Vishwarup, the sins that he incurred, he suffered terribly for 1 year, and then he got freed by giving it to 4 kinds of people in the form of Mother Earth, to water, to trees, and finally to women. And now Indra was a blank slate. So now, naturally, what do you think? The pendulum will again start swinging. He made a mistake. 1 year he suffered. Now he has given this mistakes to everyone. He has given the sins to everyone. Now again, he is going to commit mistake. This is the recurring theme of the whole 6th canto of the Bhagavatam. Errors, mistakes, and rectification. So now, after 1 year, Indra is completely free. But at this point, the father of Vishwarup, that is Tvashta, when he gets to know his son was killed, he starts doing a yajna. And the aim of this fire sacrifice, the aim of this yajna is, from this yajna, may it give birth to a demon. May it give birth to a fierce looking demon who will come out and finish Indra. Who will come out and look at Indra as his enemy. This was the aim of the yajna that Tvashta was planning to do. And Tvashta started doing the yajna. And when this yajna was done, it gave birth to a gigantic, humongous demon. This demon was huge in size. He was tall. He was dark. His eyes were spitting fire. His mouth was as wide as the caves. And when he appeared, all the sages, all the rishis, all the munis, they looked at this personality and they started saying, Vritra, Vritra, Vritra. Why? Because Vritra basically means someone who's so gigantic that his feet extends to Patal Lok and his head goes up to the Swarga Loka. That was the size of Vritrasur. His head was touching up to the Swarga Loka and his feet was going up to Patal. So you find even in English, when we are astonished, when we are surprised, no, I'm not very sure in the UK, but especially here in America, the Americans have this tendency that whenever they're astonished, they go something like, wow, wow, it's so beautiful, wow. So it's a sign of astonishment. And likewise, the sages, when they saw this form, they started saying, Vritra, 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 which means he's so gigantic that his feet go up till the Patal and his head extends up till the Swarga Loka. And because he was a demon, that was the aim of the yajna, that a demon should arise. So he was called as Vritrasur. But the thing that was perplexing here is when Vritrasur appeared, he had so much compassion. He had so much love. He had so much devotion unto everyone that he was looking unto everyone as the servants of the Lord. He was thinking to himself, everyone is part and parcel of Krishna. Everyone has to serve the Lord. Indra is the best among the servants. Here there are rishis who are serving the Lord. When Tvashta saw this, he thought to himself, wait a minute, what is this? I thought of giving birth to a demon who can kill Indra, but it seems like he's a devotee. He is speaking all philosophy. He is speaking all tattva. What is this? And Tvashta looked at the rishis. He asked the rishis, what is this? What went wrong? All my yajna still now, there were 100. I had 100% track record, but what happened? Here something has gone wrong. And the interesting thing here was Vritrasur was not seeing at Indra as his demon. But when Indra saw Vritrasur, Indra was fuming with anger. Indra was so furious that he looked at Vritrasur and he was thinking to himself, I have to kill Vritrasur. I have to destroy. I have to devour Vritrasur. So the whole yajna went for a toss. Instead of having a demon who could see Indra as his demon, as his enemy, it gave birth to Indra seeing Vritrasur as his enemy. So Tvashta was completely perplexed, just like all of us are perplexed. What has gone wrong? So when Tvashta resorted to the sages said, you did a mistake. There was a mistake in pronunciation. Instead of saying Indra Yasya Shatru, which means Indra Yasya Shatru means may this yagic sacrifice give birth to a demon who will see Indra as his demon. Instead of saying Indra Yasya Shatru, you said Indrasya Shatru, which means let this sacrifice give birth to someone whom Indra will see as his demon. So we see it is a pronunciation mistake that Tvashta did. So because of this pronunciation mistake, Vritrasur appeared, who had no envy, who had nothing wrong. He had no ill feeling against anyone, but Indra had ill feelings against Vritrasur. So now we can again imagine what is going to come up. When Indra gets angry, his mind becomes completely illusioned. He becomes completely ignorant. When he becomes ignorant, he takes such a step because of which he has to again repent. And then he will rectify. Then he will again commit a sin. So this just keeps going back and forth. So when this form of Vritrasur Indra sees, the Shastras describe Indra falls from his Airavat. Airavat is the elephant on which Indra sits. Now is the interesting part, dear devotees. This is the last section of our discussion. Indra falls from his Airavat. He thinks to himself, Vritrasur is so gigantic. How can I even kill him? In astonishment, he falls from the elephant. Now, actually, Indra could have immediately killed Vritrasur. Why? Because as we discussed, Indra had the Narayan Kavacha, which Vishwarup had given. So he could have used the Narayan Kavacha, the mantras, to kill Vishwarup. But in the event of circumstances, Indra became completely illusioned. He forgot that he had the Narayan Kavacha. And at this point, our Acharyas, dear devotees, make an interesting point. Tvashta made a pronunciation mistake because of which the whole yagic sacrifice went for a toss. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he understands this. He understands that in Kali Yuga, people are coming from different places. The Indians probably can pronounce Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. But the Chinese, they pronounce Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. The Russians have a different pronunciation. So every people of different race, they have a different pronunciation. So if the Supreme Lord focuses so much on pronunciation, then everyone will lose on spiritual benefit. Only Indians will get the spiritual benefit because they can pronounce Sanskrit better. But the Shastras very beautifully describes that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu understands this. Murkho vadati Vishnaya, dhiro vadati Vishnave, ubhayostu samam punyam bhavagrahi Janardana. Murkho vadati Vishnaya, a murkha, a fool, may say Vishnaya. But dhiro vadati Vishnave, a pandit, a scholar, may say Vishnave. So the right pronunciation is Vishnave. But the Supreme Lord, he doesn't see all these pronunciation. Ubhayostu samam punyam. Both get the same benefit. Why? Because Krishna sees to himself that, oh, he is trying to take my names. He is making an effort. He may be pronouncing it wrong, but at the end of the day, he is trying to take my names. Bhava Grahi Janardana. Janardana, Krishna sees only the bhav. He doesn't see the pronunciation mistake. So when Kali, pronunciation has to be considered, then probably every one of us would make pronunciation mistakes like the way Tvashta did. And all our bhakti would go for a toss. Even when we are pronouncing everything right, still we see we have so much nama aparad. What to speak when we start making pronunciation mistakes? So for this reason, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he makes sure that he gives very simple process of chanting Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. These mantras are so simple that anyone can chant them. Krishna, Madhava, Govinda, Gopal. These names are very simple. Anyone and everyone can pronounce them. the 8th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam very beautifully describes mantratas tantratas chidra deshakalartha vastutah sarvam karoti nischidram anusankirtanam tava. Sarvam karoti nischidram. The example is given, for example, if you're doing deity worship and instead of showing the ghee lamp with the right hand, if someone shows it with his left hand, but if he's chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, he will not incur any sin. Why? Sarvam karoti nischidram. Whatever mistakes one makes, if one is chanting the holy name, Anu Sankirtanam Tava, the Sankirtan, Naam Sankirtan, will make sure that whatever mistakes we do is completely rectified. So the holy names of the Lord is like an M seal. Whatever mistake we make, it seals our chitta. It seals our consciousness so that we don't make mistakes again. So here, Tvashta made a pronunciation mistake which gave birth to Vritrasur. When Indra saw all this, he fell from his airavat. And naturally, he got so frantic, he didn't understand what to do. So now he ran to Vishnu. So earlier he went to Brahma. Now he goes to Vishnu. And he tells Vishnu, please protect me. Vritrasur has appeared from the sacrificial fire and there is no way I can kill him. He is so gigantic. Oh Vishnu, oh Supreme Lord, oh Supreme Personality of Godhead, please give me a remedy by which I can kill him. Vishnu, when he hears this, he says, wait a minute. What is this? You offend Brihaspati. To rectify that, you go to Brahmaji. In the due course, the demons come and attack you. Then you go down to Vishwarup. Vishwarup is trying to protect you, chop off the 3 heads of Vishwarup. And then you incur sin. You get those sin, you suffer for 1 year. And because of you, you give the sins to 4 other kinds of people. And now Vritrasur has appeared. And now you want to kill Vritrasur. What is this? Indra, have some shame. You are Devaraj. What is this? Like a pendulum from gentleman to gentleman to gentleman to gentleman. You're just swinging. You should lead by example. You should set an example. What is this? Indra says, I know. I somehow forget it. When the time of crisis comes, I somehow forget it. This time you give me a remedy, I will make sure I will not do it again. And now we know this is only for talking purpose. Again, he's going to commit mistakes. 7th canto, 8th canto, 9th canto, 10th canto. Again, Indra is going to commit mistakes. So he only speaks, but he never follows it. Like Srila Gurugovinda Maharaj would say, Mukhe bole, only lip service, not practicing in real life, only just speaking. So Indra is like that. He only speaks, but doesn't practice anything. So he goes to Vishnu. Vishnu says, the remedy for this is you go to Dadichi Rishi. You go to Dadichi Muni. And you go to Dadichi Muni and beg for the bones of Dadichi Muni. And from that bones of Dadichi Muni, you prepare a thunderbolt. And with that thunderbolt, you can kill Vritrasur. So when Indra gets to know, Indra immediately comes to Dadichi Rishi. Now Dadichi Muni is a very interesting personality. He is a sadhu, he's a yogi who's very powerful. Now, as Shastras describe, he has all the siddhis, anima, lagima, mahima. He has all the siddhis, lighter than the lightest, heavier than the heaviest. He has all these powerful siddhis with him. So before Indra could come, the Ashwini Kumaras, they came to Dadichi Rishi. Now, who are the Ashwini Kumaras? Well, the Ashwini Kumaras are the physicians of the Swargaloka. In the present day, if you have to put it, the Ashwini Kumaras are the frontline workers in the Swargaloka. They are the frontline workers of the Swargaloka. So the Ashwini Kumaras, they go and meet Dadichi Rishi. And they tell Dadichi Rishi that, we want Brahma Gyan. We want Brahma Gyan from you. Can you please give us Brahma Gyan? And before the Ashwini Kumaras went, Indra had warned Dadichi Rishi that you should not give Brahma Gyan to the Ashwini Kumaras. Why? Because Indra always has this fear. Indra thinks to himself that if Ashwini Kumaras get Brahma Gyan, which means they will become proficient in Shastra, if they become proficient in Shastra, they will do Ashwamedha Yajna. If they will do 100 Ashwamedha Yajna, which means they will become the next Indra. If they become the next Indra, which means I will be kicked out. So he has always constant fear. So he goes and tells Zaditi Rishi, make sure you don't give the Ashwini Kumaras Brahma Gyan. If you give them Brahma Gyan, I will chop your head off. So you see, there is no improvement. Time and again, it is Punar Mushiko Bhava, again and again making the same mistake. So Dadichi Rishi, he tells Ashwini Kumaras, I can give you Brahma Gyan, but look, Indra has threatened me. So I don't want to lose my life, and because of that, I cannot give you. So when Ashwini Kumaras hear this, Ashwini Kumaras are extra smart. They tell Dadichi Rishi that, look, we have a plan. What we'll do is, we will take your head off, we will cut your head, and we will give you a horse head. With that horse head, you speak Brahma Gyan. And when Indra gets to know, he will get angry, he will cut that horse head off. And when he cuts that horse head, we will again give your original head. In this way, you will have your original head. At the same time, we will get Brahma Gyan. So the Ashwini Kumaras are extra smart. In Hindi, we say shane, dead shane. They are extra smart. So this plan was made. And the head of Dadichi Rishi was nicely taken and a horse head was given. And in horse head, Dadichi Rishi gave the Brahma Gyan to the Ashwini Kumaras. Now, when Indra got to know, Indra did not kill Dadichi Rishi. Why? Because Indra was playing his trump card. He now wanted help from Dadichi Rishi to kill Vritrasur. He wanted the bones of Dadichi Rishi. So he very politely, he came to Dadichi Rishi and he said, oh Rishivar, oh Munivar, you are so great. You are so tapasvi. You do so much yajnas. You are in meditation all the time. You see, this is only for saying. No, in Hindi, we say maska marna, to butter. Indra is simply buttering Dadichi Rishi. He's saying, you are so great. And the Dadichi Rishi, he understands that Indra wants something. He says, what is it? Why have you come here? Indra very shamelessly looks at him and says, can you please die? I need your bones. Can you please die? Because if you die from your bones, I can make a thunderbolt and I can go and kill Vritrasur. And Indra says, I give you two options. Either you die on your own and give me your bones, or otherwise I will take my sword and kill you. So the option is yours. Either you die or I will kill you. So you see, there is no improvement. Time and again, he's making the same mistakes. So when Dadichi Rishi understands this, he goes into meditation. He goes into samadhi. And in fraction of a second, Dadichi Rishi, he gives up his body. When he gives up his body, Indra takes all the bones and goes to Vishwakarma. Who is Vishwakarma? Vishwakarma is the architect of the heavenly kingdom. So he goes to Vishwakarma and says, these are the bones of Dadichi Rishi. Can you please prepare a thunderbolt? So Vishwakarma nicely prepares a thunderbolt. And when Indra gets this thunderbolt, he now comes back to Vritrasur to kill Vritrasur. So he sits on the Airavat, and with this thunderbolt, he charges towards Vritrasur. And Vritrasur is no less. When Indra is having a thunderbolt, now comes the fight between Vritrasur and Indra. When Indra is coming with this thunderbolt, he is charging towards Vritrasur. At that time, Vritrasur is having a mace. He's having a club in his hand. And he's spinning his club. Now, we can imagine if someone is 7 feet or 8 feet and he has a club and he's spinning, how terrifying and how traumatizing it can be. What to speak of that person whose head is touching Swargalok and his feet is going up to Patal, and he has, on top of his gigantic size, he has a club, he has a mace. Vritrasur was swinging. And now when the demigods, when the devatas, when they see this, they become very fearful and they start running. They leave the battle, they turn their back and they start running. When they turn their back and start running, the demons take this as an opportunity and they start running behind the demigods in order to kill them. When Vritrasur sees this, Ritarsu says, wait a minute, stop. First of all, you should not be killing someone who's leaving the battle. And secondly, they're showing their back. This is adharma. You should not be doing this. Now, just to reiterate, dear devotees, he is an asur, Vritra asur. He's an asur, but he's speaking philosophy. He's speaking dharma. He's saying that if someone is running from the battle, you should not kill them, especially when they're showing their back. This is adharma. You should not do it. When Indra gets to know, he thinks to himself, wait a minute. What is this? What is this person speaking? All the while I thought that he was a demon, but he's speaking dharma. He's speaking philosophy. What is this? But Indra still charges. And Indra, he throws the thunderbolt on Vritrasur. When Indra throws the thunderbolt on Vritrasur, the thunderbolt pierces the body of Vritrasur and Vritrasur falls to the ground. And when Vritrasur falls to the ground, Indra is slowly, is walking. You know, many times we see in many of the daily soaps, you find whenever something like this happens, they kind of walk slowly in order to see whether that person is actually dead. Where is this coming from? This is coming from the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam. All the daily soaps that we find, the theme, the origin is coming from the pages of the Bhagavatam. But the only difference is the Bhagavatam is the purified state, while the so-called daily soaps are the perverted reflection. So they are taking the theme, they are taking the storyline from the pages of the Bhagavatam. So here we find after throwing the thunderbolt and after Vritrasura has fallen down to the ground, Indra is slowly walking just to see whether Vritrasura is dead. When he comes close, Vritrasura with full energy, he picks up Indra and swallows Indra. What just happened? There was a battle going on. Indra threw the thunderbolt and Vritrasura had fallen to the ground. And when Indra came closer, Vritrasura picked up Indra and swallowed Indra. Done. Game, set, and match. It's all done. There was no battle. Indra was inside the stomach of Vritrasura. But Vritrasura, who had swallowed Indra, Indra from inside with that thunderbolt, he pierced, he tore open Vritrasura from inside. And when he tore open Vritrasura, he came out and sat on the shoulder, he sat on the neck of Vritrasura. And when he sat on the neck of Vritrasura, he started chopping the head of Vritrasura with that thunderbolt. With that thunderbolt, he starts chopping the head of Vritrasura. And at this time, dear devotees, Vritrasura does something which is unbelievable, which is unparalleled. Vritrasura at this point chants 4 shlokas at the time of his death, beseeching the Supreme Lord. When Indra was trying to kill him, he is in fact telling Indra, you kill me fast. The faster you kill me, the faster I can go back to Krishna. The faster I go back to Krishna, the faster I can become his servant. And the faster I become his servant, the faster I can experience happiness. The faster I can experience bliss. So, oh Indra, please kill me so that I can go back to Krishna fast. When Indra hears this, he thinks, what is this? His name is demon, but he's a Mahabhagavad Vaishnava. He wants to be with Krishna more than I want to be with Krishna. What is going on? Indra at that time, dear devotees, chants 4 shlokas, which are literally on par with the Chatushloki Bhagavatam. Canto 6, chapter 11, text 24, 25, 26, 27. The last 4 prayers of Vritrasura when he is departing this world. Vritrasura, when he is departing, he says,
Aham hare tava padaye kamola dasanu daso bhavitasmi bhuyaha manasmareta supater gunamste grinhita vakarma karotu kayaha nanaka prishtham nacha parameshtyam na sarvabhaumam na rasadhipatyam na yoga siddhira punarbhavam va samanjasatva virahaya kangshi.
What is Vritrasura saying? वृत्रासुर सिंह अहम हरे तव पादैक मूलम दासानु दासो भवितास्मि भूय. माय डियर लॉर्ड, इफ आई हैव अ रीबर्थ then may lifetime after lifetime may I be the servant of your servant of your servant. This is the only prayer I'm asking you, my dear Lord. So basically what Vritrasura is praying is Gopi Bhartur Padakamalayor Dasa 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 Anudas, to be the servant of the servant of the servant. Now Indra is hearing all this. Dasa Anudaso Bhavitasmi Bhuya Manhas Maret Tasu Pater Gunams, then may my mind be always engaged in remembering your pastimes. And grinhita vak, may my tongue and karotu kaya, and may my actions always remember you. So my dear Lord, may lifetime after lifetime, may I become your servant. And may lifetime after lifetime, may my tongue, my mind and my actions always be engaged in devotional service, in pure devotional service. Nanaka prishtham nachaparameshtam. My dear Lord, I don't even want Dhruva Loka. Nanaka prishtham nachaparameshtam na sarva bhaumam narasadipathyam. My dear Lord, I don't want Dhruva Loka. I don't want Brahma Loka. I don't want the heavenly planets. I don't want the lower planetary systems. Na yoga siddhi. My dear Lord, I don't even want yoga siddhi. Apunar bhavamba, my dear Lord, I don't even want liberation. So the Lord is asking, what do you want? You don't want liberation. You don't want siddhis. You don't want Dhruva Loka. You don't want Brahma Loka. You don't want lower planetary systems. You don't want higher planetary systems. So as if like Krishna is asking, oh, Vritrasur, at the time of death, what do you want? And that time Vritrasur says, virahaya kangshi, my dear Lord, if by getting all these things, I am going to be separated from you, I don't want any of these things. The only thing I want is the constant association of you and your devotees. And by getting all these things, if my mind is going to get illusioned like Indra, Indra is Devaraj and time and again, he gets illusioned. Vritrasura is saying, my dear Lord, I don't want to be in that place. If by getting prestige and pride and position and opulence and name and fame and recognition in this world, if I am going to be separated from you and your devotees, my dear Lord, best, I don't want any of these things. And then Vritrasur says, my dear Lord, let me explain my love for you in three ways. Vritrasur gives three examples to the Supreme Lord. Now, just to reiterate, dear devotees, Vritrasur is at the time of death. At the time of death, this is what Vritrasur is thinking and remembering. And Indra, who is about to chop the head of Vritrasur, sitting on the shoulder, is thinking, what is going on? All the while I thought he's a demon, but seems like now I'm going to get another Vaishnava Prad of killing Vritrasur. His name is an Asur, but he is chanting the best among verses. Vritrasur at that time, he continues by saying, Ajata Paksha Iva Mataram Khaga Sthanyam Yathavat Sarataksudartha Priyam Priyaiva Vyushitam Vishanna Mano Ravendraksha Dedekshate Tvam Mama Uttama Shloka Janeshu Sakhyam Samsara Chakre Brahmata Swakarmabhi Tvanmaya Yatma Majadara Geheshu Asakta Chittasya Nanaka Bhuyat. Vritrasura says, Ajata Paksha Iva Mataram Khaga, my dear Lord, just like a small bird, a baby bird, a wingless bird that has just born, we find that bird is so dependent on the mother for food, for shelter, for water, for everything. Vritrasura says, my dear Lord, I am like that. You are the mother bird and I am like that small baby bird. I am completely dependent upon you. And second example he gives is the example of a calf and a cow. Just like the calf is constantly around the cow, mother cow. He says, my dear Lord, you are the all pure mother cow. And I am like that calf. I always want to seek your association. And finally, the third example he gives is that of a lover and a beloved. He says, my dear Lord, just like when a wife is separated from the husband, all the time she's only thinking of her husband as to when she will return. Similarly, my dear Lord, you are like that husband and I am like that devotee who's being separated from you. Please give me this benediction so that soon, very soon, I can come back to the service of your lotus feet. Now Indra is hearing all this. Indra thinks to himself, should I kill him or should I not kill him? If I don't kill him, he's a demon, he's a gigantic demon. And if I kill him, I'm going to get Vaishnava Parad. And at this time, Vritrasur says, he looks at Indra and says, please kill me fast. If you kill me, I can go back to Krishna. Please don't delay. Oh, Indra, please kill me. You have made this thunderbolt. And for this thunderbolt, Dadichi Rishi has given his life. Please don't make the efforts of Dadichi Rishi giving up his life in vain. Please, please kill me. I am requesting you. I am begging you. Please kill me. So Indra, with his thunderbolt, he kills Vritrasur. And Vritrasur falls to the ground dead. And then Vritrasur goes back home, back to garden. But now, there should be a very interesting question that should rise in all our minds. The question is, Vritrasur appeared as a demon. How is it that at the time of death, he was chanting verses? How is it that he had so much bhakti that at the end, he was remembering the Supreme Lord and beseeching the Lord to serve him eternally in the Lord's pastimes? How did this happen? Shukadev Goswami very beautifully describes. Many years back, there was a very famous king by the name Chitraketu Maharaj. Chitraketu Maharaj had many queens and he was living a very luxurious life, just like the way kings would live. But there was one problem. The problem that Chitraketu Maharaj had is he did not have a son. He tried everything possible, but somehow he didn't have a son. So he would always be under this anxiety that why is it that I don't have a son? Everyone has a son, but I don't have a son. Who will carry forward this legacy? Who will be the next heir to this throne? So day and night he would weep and he would think, why is it that I don't have any son? And at this point, when he was contemplating this way, when he was in anxiety this way, Angira Rishi, Angira Muni, he walks into the assembly, he walks into the kingdom of Chitraketu Maharaj. And when Chitraketu Maharaj, he sees Angira Rishi, he falls at the feet of Angira Rishi and says, oh Rishi, you are a sadhu, you can fulfill all the desires. Please fulfill this desire of mine. Angira Rishi says, what is the desire? And Chitraketu Maharaj narrates as to how he doesn't have a son. So Angira Rishi, when he hears this, he says, look, you have heard so many stories from the scriptures in the form of King Sagara, in the form of the Atmadev Brahmana. All of them tried to tweak with destiny in the form of getting a son, but it all backfired. None of them were successful. Chitraketu Maharaj said, no, it happened with them, but it will not happen with me. I will make sure that my son is very dignified and very obedient and very cultured and very spiritually minded. So Angira Rishi, when he heard this, he said, you see, history is going to repeat. I am giving you this warning that if you get a son, he is going to give you more sorrow, more suffering than what you have. Angira Rishi said, no, I want a son. Please give me a son. He started begging. So Angira Rishi understood that there is no point speaking philosophy here. So he gave a fruit and he said, please give this fruit to your wife. And after having this fruit, you will get a son who will give happiness. At the same time, he will also give distress. So when Chitraketu Maharaj heard this, he became very happy. And he went to his wife Kritadyuti and he gave this fruit and asked Kritadyuti that, can you have this fruit? And Kritadyuti had this fruit and she gave birth to a son. And this son, dear devotees, was named as Harsha Shoka because he gave Harsha happiness and he also gave Shoka distress. But the point here was, after the son was born, naturally Chitraketu Maharaj's love and affection for other queens decreased and his love and affection for Kritadyuti increased. Why? Because Kritadyuti was the mother of this child. So naturally, there was envy in the whole family. And the other queens, they started to think to themselves that before this child appeared, Chitraketu Maharaj was giving us equal love and affection. But after this child has appeared, seems like Krita Dyuti is stealing the show. We are not getting any time with our husband. He is not giving us any love. So the root cause, the root problem is the son. Let us poison and let us kill the son once and for all. So they poisoned the son, and this son, Harshashoka, he died. When Harshashoka died, Chitraketu Maharaj was weeping. He was thinking to himself, what happened? I just had a son, and even before happiness could enter my heart, it seems like there is distress once again. So at that time, Angira Rishi and Narada Rishi, they again walked into the assembly. So Chitraketu Maharaj fell at their feet and said, please do something. My son just died. Angira Rishi said, I told you that he is going to give more suffering, but you didn't accept. You didn't accept my advice. Chitraketu Maharaj said, no, please give me my son back. I will follow everything. He started crying once again. So when Narad Rishi saw everything, Narad Rishi kept his hand on the head of this son, and the son again reappeared. He again came back to life. And when he came back to life, Chitraketu Maharaj was very happy. Chitraketu Maharaj said, oh, you're back again, my son. And he went to embrace his son. And the son said, wait a minute. Who are you? You say you are my parent? Which lifetime? I have had parents for so many lifetimes together. Which lifetime are you talking about? So the child started speaking philosophy. Chitraketu Maharaj looked at Narad Muni and said, what is he talking? He's just a young child. What philosophy is talking? Narad Rishi said, look, he's now got self-realization. So he doesn't want to be here. And my advice to you is you should also give up family life. Give up this bondage and go to the forest and do bhajan and please the Supreme Lord. So when Chitraketu Maharaj heard this instruction from Narad Muni, and he understood that his son had no interest to live in the family because he was completely self-realized, On Narad Muni's advice, Chitraketu Maharaj went to the forest. And within 1 month, Chitraketu Maharaj did bhajan, did chanting, did tapasya. And in 1 month, he saw Sankarshan. He saw the Supreme Personality of Godhead face to face. And after Chitraketu Maharaj was completely self-realized, and when he was again going back home, back to Godhead, in the Viman, in the airplane, Chitraketu Maharaj was going in Air Vaikunta. We have Air India and so many other airlines. Similarly, Chitraketu Maharaj was going in Air Vaikunta. He was going back home, back to Godhead. But when he was going back home, back to Godhead, he was seeing different places around him. And he was crossing Kailas. And at that time in Kailas, Lord Shiva was speaking Bhagavatam. Lord Shiva was speaking beautifully, chanting different verses of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And he was glorifying the scripture Bhagavatam. But when he was speaking about Bhagavatam, he was having Parvati, his wife, on his lap. So he was speaking about renunciation, having his wife on his lap. So we don't generally find speakers having their wife sitting on their lap. But Lord Shiva was having Parvati on her lap and he was speaking Srimad Bhagavatam. So when Chitraketu Maharaj was going back home, back to Godhead, he saw this sight. And in a very joking way, he looked at Indra and he looked at Lord Shiva. And he said, interesting. Speaking about renunciation, having your own wife on your lap. Nice. Interesting way of speaking Bhagavatam. And Lord Shiva understood that Chitraketu Maharaj was, in a friendly way he was speaking. He was not criticizing. In fact, Chitraketu Maharaj was glorifying Indra. He was glorifying Lord Shiva by saying that Lord Shiva is so glorious that he's speaking about renunciation by keeping his wife on his lap, which probably no one can ever do. So he was glorifying. But when Parvati heard this, Lord Shiva took it in the right sense. But when Parvati heard this, she became furious. She became very angry. She thought to herself, you have the audacity to criticize Mahadev? Just because you're going back home, back to Godhead, that means you can say anything? You have the audacity to criticize Shambhu, who is the best among devotees? He's Vaishnavana Mahashambhu. and you are the audacity to criticize him. Chitraketu Maharaj said, no, mother, I was not criticizing. I was in fact glorifying. Parvati said, no, you were not glorifying, you were criticizing him. And for that, O Chitraketu Maharaj, I curse you. I curse you because you spoke like a demon. I curse you that may you take another birth in the form of a demon. When Chitraketu Maharaj heard this, he said, whatever you feel right, mother, I will do it. He did not argue. He did not say, no, I didn't say this. This was the meaning. He didn't try to justify. He said, mother, if you feel I'm not qualified, that means I'm not qualified. And Parvati cursed Chitraketu Maharaj that may you become a demon because you spoke like a demon. And dear devotees, Chitraketu Maharaj reincarnated as Vritrasura. It was the same Chitraketu Maharaj because of that curse of Mother Parvati incarnated as Vritrasura. And when Vritrasura appeared, because Chitraketu Maharaj had done bhajan and was completely self-realized, it is for that reason that Vritrasura, even at the time of his death, could chant beautiful Sanskrit verses and remember the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. So the inspirational lesson that we find from this whole section is bhakti is something that is an eternal investment. Neha mikramanasosti pratyavayona vidyate svalpam apyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhayat. The Bhagavad Gita describes even little bhakti that is done is not never wasted. Material wealth goes away with time. When someone dies, material wealth is left behind. But spiritual wealth is such, even after death, the spiritual wealth can be taken. And this pastime of Chitraketu taking his self-realization to the life of Vritrasura is the best example that bhakti is carry forwarded from one lifetime to another lifetime to another lifetime. So that is why Prabhupada would always make this point that human life means collection of spiritual wealth and not just material wealth, because material wealth fades away with time. Spiritual wealth eternally is there with time. So we find in this way, Chitraketu Maharaj was self-realized, and because of the curse of Mother Parvati came as Vritrasura. And even though he came as Vritrasura, his name was Asur, but the verses that he was chanting were like that of a devotee. That is why in many places we find, especially the Brajavasis, when they narrate this pastime, they don't address him as Vritrasura, but they address him as Vritra Mahabhagavat, because these prayers can be chanted only by a pure devotee and not by a demon. So it is very important that we bookmark these four prayers of Vritrasura and chant them every day. Every day when we get up and before going to sleep, we chant these prayers of Vritrasura, beseeching the Lord that, my dear Lord, lifetime after lifetime, may I only be your servant. And my lifetime after lifetime, may my tongue, mind, and my actions be absorbed in your activities. Having said this, I stop here. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna. Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Chitraketu Vritrasura Prasang ki jai. Patita Pavachila Prabhupada ki jai. Samasta Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. Hare Krishna.